And love our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
To proclaim your truth. And please, Holy Spirit, anoint our hearts to be receptive to you and to your will. We've come to worship you, but we've also come to hear from you, Lord. So have your way, Holy Spirit, in this preaching moment. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So thankful for the ministry of our praise team, Brother Dominic Jackson and Brother Steve Key on the piano, Sister Jordan Furbish as the praise leader, and Minister Charmaine Furbish. Thank you so much for ministering. Thank God for our praise team. One of these days, we're going to have the drums and everything, but, you know, for now, we're just thankful for how the Lord has blessed our praise team. So thankful also. I want to say a word of appreciation to Reverend Barbara Breland and Minister Victor Powell. These past two Sundays, we have had awesome, wonderful preaching from this pulpit, and so thankful. Last week was Usher's Day. And I was here, but I had to cut out to do another assignment. But so thankful for the word that Minister Powell brought, and Reverend Breland also the week before. Very grateful for the ministers here at Third Street and how they are willing to serve us in such a wonderful way. We're still on the theme of trying something new in 2022. The lesson has been read from Acts chapter 17, and I want to pick up where Garrett left off, he read the verses, Acts chapter 17, beginning at verse 16, where Paul is in Athens, and he's responding to the presence of idols. And you know, an idol is an artifact. It's a statue to a god, and there were many gods that the Athenians worshipped, and they built representations, images of those gods. That's what an idol is. And there were many of them, and the idols distressed Paul. But he also went to engage the philosophers at the Areopagus, also known as Mars Hill. It's a gathering of philosophers, and so they were listening to what Paul had to say. And all of the Bible says in verse 21 of Acts chapter 17, all of the Athenians and the foreigners living there, so it was a cosmopolitan city, it was a place of great commerce and culture, and people came from all over through Athens, would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. They like to hear new things. They like to entertain new ideas. Then Paul stood, verse 22, in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription to an unknown God. Now, I want to pause for a moment there and say, the Bible tells us that Paul was distressed by the idolatry, but when he was speaking to them, he didn't speak negatively. He just said, I looked, and this is what I saw. And sometimes we are too quick to be negative and condemning of people when we're trying to minister to them. So I just want you to observe. He didn't say, y'all had these No, he's like, okay, I saw what you have. But one of them said, unknown God. What you therefore worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. Do you see where he found an opening? And he found a way to connect with them in a positive way. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor, he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth. And he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live. So they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him. Though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. Even as some of your own poets have said, now, let me pause right there. Some of your own poets. So that meant that Paul had read up on the poetry of the Athenian culture. He had paid attention. He didn't say, yeah, your poets, they are idolaters. No, I read your poetry. So let me read it back to you. I read some of your poetry. You said, we too, your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring. You see where he took a line from their poetry and said, I agree with that. See, that's why you don't trash other people's culture. He used that as a basis for saying, since we are God's offspring, I agree with you, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, Now he commends all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. When they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some scoffed. But others said, "We will hear you again about this." At that point, Paul left them. But verse 34, some of them joined him and became believers, including Dionysius the Areopagite and a woman named Damaris and others with them. So when Paul gave his speech, made his appeal, he got different responses, but some people believed and joined the ministry, the community, the vision that Paul presented. I believe what we have in Acts chapter 17 is a view of Paul's intellectual engagement across the boundaries of religion and culture. He's thinking ahead of time before he starts speaking. He's thinking about how to take their culture and their literature and engage the questions, engage the ideas that they're already thinking about in order to present something new. He's not dismissive of their culture or their religion, even though he's distressed by it. But he crosses the boundaries of religion and culture in his presentation of the good news of Jesus Christ. And he presents a new teaching. Because remember now, these people, they always want to hear something new. So Paul is bringing something new. And what he brings has three fresh perspectives on human existence. When we present the gospel to people, we have to be mindful of whether or not what we're saying has anything to do with their lives. Because sometimes we miss the boat. We talk about stuff that people are not even thinking about or not caring about. But we have to make sure that what we present, and Paul is doing this here, what you present speaks to the issues of human life that people care about and think about and sometimes worry about. So he proclaims a new birth. He proclaims a new life. And he proclaims a new perspective on death. So there you have it. In my thinking anyway, he's addressing the whole realm of human existence. A new birth, a new life, and a new perspective on death. He says that when he proclaims the unknown God, he says that in him we live and move and have our being. Verse 28. My understanding of that verse always takes me back to my experience of giving birth. I can't remember when I was born. Nobody can remember. You can't remember that experience, that whether it was traumatic or whether it was easy. You can't remember when you were born. You can't remember. I mean, they might tell you what it was like, but you don't remember. But if you give birth, you remember. You don't just forget. And I remember having a conversation with one of my colleagues at the university, and I was saying, you know what? I nailed it. So you get to a certain point in the pregnancy where they start elbowing you and kicking and, you know, I mean, and that's all good, right? Because you want to make sure that, you know, although it might give you a little bit, but it's like you have an awareness in pregnancy that you don't just have a big belly, but there's life that is taken. And I keep doing this because that's what mine did to me. It's elbow. And sometimes you can see it. You can see it. See them punching and kicking you, right? But it's all good because you know, you're glad for them to be moving. In him they move and have our being. See, if we have this masculine, many of us, we only want to refer to God as Father. But in him we live and move and have our being. This is a perfect image of pregnancy. That we are in the womb of God. I know some of you, God, we're in the womb of God. And God is giving birth to, nobody has life unless God gave birth to you. That's what it means to be God's children. Okay? Now I'm not negating the image of God as Father. I'm just trying to expand your thinking based on what Paul said. In him we live and move and have our being. And so there's a new understanding of birth that comes to us when we see God in that way. There's a new life that Paul is presenting. Again, connecting with their sense of human existence. Verse 26, from one ancestor. I think the King James say one blood. But since we know like about DNA and all that, we don't say one blood. But bottom translation, one ancestor. God made all nations. Anthropologists call that one ancestor Eve. You know, scientists, long time ago, scientists figured this one out. That God made all nations from one ancestor. Now, some people, the people who subscribe to the structures of race and racism will have a problem with this. That there's really only one human race. And that we made up all the rest of them. Really? This whole problem of race, we made it up. People made that up. There's one race, and it's human. And the fact that we're different colors, different sizes, different kinds of hair, it's really insignificant. Certainly from a scientific point of view, it's very insignificant. But our societies, our nations, our economies have made a big deal out of race when they found out that they could make money doing it. Now, I'll just leave my critical race theory right there. One ancestor. In the Bible, the ancestor is Eve, but there's an anthropological Eve. One ancestor to inhabit the whole earth. So we're all, our life is different if we see ourselves as all belonging to one family. That if you're convinced it's them over there and them over here, whether it's racism or nationalism. That nationalism creates a lot of division politically and economically as well. But if we could have as our main, when we think about human life, if our first thought is that God made one race, we have one ancestor, and God intended for us to inhabit the whole earth, so the whole planet belongs to all of us. It's a different perspective on ecology, a different perspective on global economy, and a different perspective on the problems of injustice and race. There's also a new perspective on death. What Paul does in his speech, he's showing them some new things, challenging them to think some new thoughts, but he slips in a demand for repentance. And what is repentance? It's a drastic change in thought and behavior that will prepare us to return to God when we die like everybody else is going to die and stand in the day of judgment. Verse 31, for he has set a day. That's what God has done. set a day for judging the world with justice by the man he has appointed. And he proved to everyone who this is by raising him from the dead. So there you have it. See, now they really got upset, the listeners, when he talked about the resurrection of the dead. But that's the good news of Jesus Christ, that the man whom God appointed to be the judge, God raised him from the dead. And everyone in the world will be held accountable for justice on the day of judgment. Verse 42 of Acts chapter 10 says, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as the judge of the living and the dead. So, simple concept here in terms of death. Yes, as Christians, we confess that Jesus died for our sins, but Jesus is the judge of the living and the dead. So that means you're either one or the other. Either you're living or you're dead, but whether you're living or dead, you are under the judgment of Jesus Christ. And the only way to respond to that, the best way to respond to that status is to repent. Now, Paul demonstrates his ability to teach new information and to encourage people to make new commitments by engaging their points of reference. See, he looks at their idols. He reads their literature. He listens to how they exchange ideas in this arena of conversation. So he familiarizes himself with how they communicate. But I want to name some things that he specifically does that I think we would do well to examine and learn from as we face the challenges in our current day of how we communicate across the boundaries of culture and race and religion and age and so many things. Three things: a cultural aesthetic, a creative homiletics, and a courageous apologetics. A cultural aesthetic. As I've already showed you, Paul acquainted himself with the literature, the art, and the values of the Athenians before he began to engage them. And he is somewhat unique in this regard. Remember, among the apostles who are leading the church in the book of Acts, he was the only one who did not follow Jesus while Jesus was alive. Remember, Paul had his encounter with Jesus when he was on the road to Damascus. But all the other apostles were people that Jesus had called, but they were fishermen, tax collectors, political activists. They weren't people who had the cultural and literary education that Paul had. Now, Peter was a fisherman. He did a good job as a fisherman, but he didn't have this cultural aesthetic that Paul had. Paul had a certain kind of knowledge of the culture, and he used that. How are you going to engage people with ideas or even present the gospel to people if you have no idea what they're normally listening to and talking about? And it's not easy because some of popular culture, some of us are as distressed by popular culture as Paul was by those idols. And we look at let me just talk about me, okay? There's some things in popular culture, popular music, celebrity culture that I just don't. But I recognize that if those things are valuable and meaningful to people, you can't be dismissive of it if you're trying to talk to people. So you at least have to have some acquaintance. What movies are they watching? What music are they listening to? Who are the people they admire? You at least have to know this if you're going to engage them in conversation. That's what I mean by cultural aesthetics. And you don't necessarily have to subscribe to that value system, but at least recognize that people that you're trying to minister to may have different values than you do. In fact, you can pretty much count on it. But if you're going to reach them, at least show them that you have some appreciation for their culture. How about that? Now, that's a stretch. This is a stretch, but I think that's what we have to figure out how to do. Also, we have with Paul a creative homiletics. A creative homiletics. And what homiletics just, the term in theological education, it means preaching or teaching, preaching. But literally, the word means a conversation with the crowd. So the term homiletics is communication, creative communication. What do you have to do? Speak your truth in their language. The Bible doesn't say that Paul had a translator. Now, some of us need a translator. If all y'all that are listening to me were, your language was Spanish, I don't speak Spanish. If I was going to speak to you, I'd have to have somebody translate. If you were Korean, and you know, we've had a lot of ministry in our community. When we had our community worship service, we had a lot of Koreans who would come, and sometimes they would speak and pray in Korean, and if we didn't have anybody translate, we don't know what they were saying. So you need a translator if you don't speak the same language. Everybody knows this. But Paul was able to speak their language. And so if you're going to present truth or speak truth, either you have to know their language or you have to make sure that what you are speaking is clearly and accurately translated. And let me also add, if you care. Because a lot of us don't care enough to either learn somebody else's language or translate when we don't know it to make sure that it gets heard. It's how you can, if you come into my space and I know you don't know my language, I can ignore you. And just say, well, that's too bad. Or I can say, let me make sure that you can hear what's being spoken. That's what I mean by creative homiletics. Now, it's not always that extreme, but sometimes preachers use church language in settings where people don't have any idea what in the world you're talking about. And you can say, oh, they haven't been to church. Well, yeah, maybe they haven't. And maybe you need to get out some more. That doesn't sound nice, did it? But y'all understand what I'm trying to say, right? Learn the language of the people you're trying to reach. And then the courageous apologetics. I was trying to show you, reread that Acts chapter 17. What's going on? Paul is going toe-to-toe with the philosophers with a debate that does not denigrate. That's what I mean by courageous apologetics. Sometimes when, and I find myself in this situation all the time, you get into a conversation where there's a profound disagreement. Okay, you could say nothing, or you could take it on, but when you take on a difference of opinion, do you have to denigrate the other person's point of view? Or can you just be courageous and say, you know what, I don't agree with that, but I respect your right to disagree. And that's a skill that many of us do not have. If there's a disagreement, even we're ready to make it turn into a beat down. And a debate is not necessarily a beat down. Because, see, he's not trying to beat them down. He's trying to convince and persuade them to follow Jesus. So it's a little bit inconsistent when you come with the beat down and you're trying to get somebody to love somebody. So you got to make sure, bring your courage, bring your apologetics. That word doesn't mean apologize. That word means defend. You should be in a position where you intellectually can defend your faith. You know what you believe. You go toe-to-toe. I can't tell you how many times I've had to go toe-to-toe with people who think I'm ignorant because my field of study is religion. And there are people who say, oh, religion, well, you don't know anything. So I had to go toe-to-toe. You know what toe-to-toe means? But toe-to-toe doesn't mean I have to give, if you're giving me negativity, I don't have to give you back. See, he's letting them know I'm able and capable of conducting this conversation. But he's not being arrogant. He's not being hateful. He's saying, but I want you to know Jesus. And so we have to make sure that our attitude, our defense of our faith, we defend a position that we have taken because we love Jesus, because we believe Jesus, because we trust Jesus. Let us not contradict all of that by our negative apologetics. And it's neither is it acceptable to say, oh, you know what, I'll just get out of this because I don't. No, you can't always back off. Sometimes you can back off. But somebody needs to step up and say, this is what we believe. This is who we are. And this is the way we're going to go with it. The whole point of adopting any or all of these strategies, cultural aesthetics, creative homiletics, courageous apologetics, is to convince people to join Jesus, to experience the new creation, to acquire a new outlook and make an actual commitment to belong to a community of persons who follow what Jesus taught, who love what Jesus loved, and who acknowledge how and why he died. In the end, Dionysius and Damaris were convinced and they joined. What did they join? Did they join a church? Did they join an ethical society? Or did they join Paul on a journey of discipleship, confessing that they were willing to commit to teaching and preaching and reaching others with the distinctive words and ideas and lifestyles associated with being a Christian. That they were willing to be marked by a baptism of immersion in the waters of new birth and new life. That they were ready to be energized. We don't know much about Damaris. We just know she was a woman. Dionysius was a philosopher. So when the philosopher says, I believe, he's still a philosopher, but you know that he's got to be ready for a different kind of public witness, of holy boldness to confront every assault and even the threat of death without fear or denial or reprisal. If you read the whole chapter, and I encourage you to do so, of chapter 17 of Acts, you will see Paul's rigorous engagement of all kinds and classes of people with his message. The roughnecks of Thessalonica. Look, read the part about what happened when he was in Thessalonica. There was roughnecks. That's the nicest word I can find. The mob that came after him. Roughnecks are the kind of people that you can organize them into a mob to do somebody wrong. You don't even have to explain it. They always ready to fight. And so they had roughnecks there. He had to deal with the roughnecks. Then when he went from Thessalonica to Berea, he was with the company in the company of educated men and women. And they were people who were not only educated, they were polite. And they were so engaging of his teaching, they did their homework. It's a totally different kind of crowd The first people trying to fight him, the second people couldn't get enough of his teaching. And then he goes to the skeptics of Athens who debated his ideas. Verse 17, he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, but also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. So he went, and this is what Jesus did, the same thing, by the way. Whenever you see Jesus moving from place to place, where's the first place he goes? To the synagogue. Okay? So he went to the synagogue to engage his own people, the Jews, the devout persons, the worshipers, what we would call the church people. But he also went to the marketplace every day, and whoever happened to be there. So that's a diverse and bold public witness, that you are willing and ready to talk to whoever is there. You're not just only in conversation with the people who already believe the same thing you believe. Now, you don't ignore them, but what do you have for the marketplace? What word? What idea? What engagement? Are you even in the marketplace? But he positioned himself there, and he had conversation with everybody who happened to be there. So he probably didn't even know all the kinds of people he was going to meet, but he wasn't afraid of it. And I think sometimes we're afraid of the kind of people, because, you know, people are hard to deal with. But I'm just saying, this is what he did. So that kept, at least it kept him on his toes, didn't it? If you're in the marketplace and you're dealing with all kinds of people, then you're going to have to learn how to pivot and adjust and find a language so that you can have conversation and be a witness to all kinds of people. This is our challenge as a teaching and learning community of faith, to make our best effort to prepare ourselves for intellectual, spiritual, and cultural engagement so that we can have something for everyone we happen to meet, from the elites to the marginalized, from the devout to the profane. Paul's audience in Athens included people who were devout, included people who were critical, included people who were skeptical. And they responded to Paul's new teaching in three ways: rejection, consideration, and acceptance. Only two people, as I said, the philosopher and the woman, accepted. Well, there were a few others, they said. Those two and a few others, unnamed, believed the teaching and were convinced to join. So they accepted his teaching. Whenever teachers teach, whenever preachers preach, we should be prepared for people to respond to us in those three ways. Some will reject what you say. Some will consider, you know, they say, okay, we hear what you say, Paul. We'll continue this conversation. They really want to continue the conversation. And then others are like, oh, I believe. Oh, I accept it. This is good. You get those three kinds of responses from people. Of course, there's a fourth one that isn't accounted for there, but I'm very familiar with: indifference. What time is church over? You know, indifference, like, you know, whatever you say don't have nothing to do with me. So, well, you know, so that one, we didn't get that one with Paul, but I'm just throwing that one in there. Rejection, consideration, and acceptance. Instead of focusing on how we feel about people's responses, on how good we feel when someone speaks so highly of our preaching, or how bad we feel when we know our words are being scrutinized and disrespected, instead of focusing on how we feel, we should just stay committed to one of the most difficult challenges of ministry, and that is how to continue the conversation. The conversation with skeptics with agnostics. The agnostics are people who refuse to decide. And they take pride. Yeah, my position, well, you know, I'm not against it, I'm not for it, I'm just agnostic. Atheists, some people say, oh, no, I don't believe in God. That's a hard conversation. I've had that conversation recently. It's a very hard conversation to have, to want to continue to engage somebody who just tells you flat out, I don't believe in God. I don't believe what you're saying. So, you know, your first, what you feel like doing, say, well, forget you then. I mean, that's, I'm just saying, that's what you feel. But you have to find a way to at least stay in conversation, even if it's not easy, even if it's so hard. How do we stay in conversation with those who like us and those who don't? Because some people will tell you if they don't like you. Some people will tell you if they like you. And it may be that they just like being around you, but they're still not interested in anything you got to say. I don't want to make this too complicated, but I'm just trying to be truthful about how we sometimes oversimplify how easy it is to connect with people with new information. The challenge is hard. It's hard. But Paul did it, and Paul shows us one, at least an approach to how it can be done. So, I want to say, and I'll conclude with this, we can teach cultural aesthetics. We can teach creative homiletics. We can teach people how to interpret popular culture in a way that will enhance our ability to reach people who are immersed in popular culture but don't know God. We can teach creative homiletics, how to be effective in presenting the gospel and finding the language that people can understand and make a response to our appeal. And we can teach courageous apologetics. I think we need to do more of that in the church. What's wrong with debate? You know, we sort of kind of shy away from conflict sometimes, but how are we going to advance in our thinking and our knowledge if we don't answer hard questions? And if we're afraid when people have different opinions about things. Well, guess what? I guarantee you, if it's more than two people in the room, you're going to have two different opinions, or three, or 10. But we don't have to fear that. In fact, maybe we can practice more among ourselves how to do this toe-to-toe courageous thing. We're comfortable with engaging ideas, and we don't get mad, and we don't get violent, and we don't get dismissive, but we find a way to continue the conversation and the relationship. We can teach these things. We can equip the saints to increase the size of our audience and our influence, and to deepen the impact of our messaging. Because why do we need to do this? Because people have been ravaged by three plagues. The plague of COVID-19 has ravaged us. Even those of us who haven't gotten the disease, but it's had an impact on us. Some have been bereaved because they've lost loved ones. Some have been affected and have gone through the anxiety and fear of the disease firsthand. We have been ravaged by the plague of COVID-19. But that's not the only plague we're dealing with. People are dealing with the plague of 1619. That's what this CRT thing is all about. People don't want to deal with the truth of our past. Because the only way we're going to move forward toward reconciliation is we tell the truth about the past. Racism still plagues us. It plagues the people who are in denial and don't want to talk about it. But it plagues those of us who still got somebody's foot on our neck. So we need to recognize people have been ravaged by the plague of 1619 and the plague of war and violence. You don't have to go to Ukraine to find violence and people dying and communities overrun with weapons. The plague of violence, the plague of COVID-19, the plague of 1619. Souls have been ravaged by these plagues, and we need a new word, a new revelation, a new life for soul restoration, for healing, and for hope. That's our why. That's why we need to do this. And I believe that God has given us, even in Paul's example, a way forward so that we can speak healing and hope and reconciliation meaningfully, thoughtfully, with impact, so that people can know Jesus, so that people can join this journey of new life. Let's pray. So thankful we are, God, for your word, for your truth, how your truth challenges us and stretches us. And we pray, God, that as this message goes forth, that you will continue, as you always do, to summon men and women, boys and girls, youngsters and elders, to a higher place in you. Send your truth and give us grace to speak your truth. Show us, God, the methods and the approaches that we need to be more effective in messaging the good news of Jesus Christ to a generation that needs soul restoration. But we only believe it will come by the truth and the power of your word. Give us the courage to go toe-to-toe, to be equipped with rigor and with righteousness as we engage the issues and the challenges of our time with a deeper, fuller commitment to represent you in this world. And God, if anyone has watched this message, heard this message, and is ready to join, ready to believe, ready to pivot, ready to repent, we pray, God, for grace of repentance and a pathway of illumination, pathway of faith. We know that faith is the gift of God. And so gift us, God, with the faith and the grace to be led and to walk in the path that you've illumined before us, of hope and wholeness, of repentance and forgiveness, and of soul salvation. We claim all that we've asked according to your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's receive the benediction. Now to God, who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. And to God be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. The blessings of God for the people of God. Amen. Please be seated until...
I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without
you. Lord, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
Nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
and live in me.